Welcome to National Smile Month, where we have a final episode of the season today. Now we're talking to Gordon and Vishal, who have both been involved in the Right to Smile consensus, discussing the oral health inequalities that people with severe mental illnesses can face. We had a really lovely conversation and talked about some really important things, and I really hope that you get as much out of this conversation as I did. So I'm here with Dr. Vishal Agarwal and Gordon Johnson, who are going to share a little bit more information about mental health and oral health in general. Gordon, if we start with you, do you want to just introduce yourself quickly?
Yeah, hi, I'm Gordon Johnston. I'm 57. I live in a little village called Clipmannan in central Scotland, and I have lived experience of mental ill health, and I do a lot of work around policy and research in mental health.
Okay, and what about yourself, Vishal? Well, can we get a little bit of background to you?
Sure. So I'm an academic dentist. I'm currently a clinical associate professor at University of Leeds Dental School. My academic interests are centered around improving oral health outcomes for people in all vulnerable populations, really. And this is currently centered around people with severe mental illness and chronic pain in the face, mouth, and jaws. And the latter, so the chronic pain work has been what I'm known for in my career up to 2016 before I joined Leeds, where we've developed a supported self-management intervention to empower patients to manage their pain and live well with it. So it's about understanding problems from patient perspectives.
Mm-hmm. Which is such an important piece of work to do when we talk about anything medical. But, you know, especially with mental health, we're getting better at talking about it, but we're not quite at the point where I think we need to be. And, you know, Gordon, you've said you have lived experience with bipolar disorder. Would you like to share a little bit more information and give us a little bit of a breakdown of your experiences with bipolar, if you're comfortable doing that?
Yeah, so my story is a bit atypical in that I was around 40 before I was actually diagnosed with a mental illness. Although looking back, I had what I would now call my first manic episode when I was 17. So over many years, I've had long periods when I've been fairly stable. I've also had periods of major depression and manic episodes as well. And you know, that's had a pretty major impact on my life. And in some ways, being diagnosed at a relatively late stage allowed me to make sense of a lot of the things that I had done and that had happened to me through my life at that point. So in some ways, when I got used to the idea, it was actually quite a positive thing to have a diagnosis.
And has your experience with bipolar, how has that affected other areas of your health? Because it must impact other areas of your health in a few different ways.
It definitely does, Sophie. I mean, I think the key thing in a lot of ways is simply that your focus is so on your mental health, on getting through the challenges with that things like physical health, oral health simply don't reach the top of the to-do list. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're in a major depressive state and getting out of bed in the morning is quite a difficult thing to do. You know, the idea of getting washed, showered, dressed, cleaning your teeth, to be honest, doesn't always happen. So over many years, I would say that my oral health was not as good as it should have been. Mm-hmm. I got out of the habit of going to the dentist. And I think, like a lot of things in life, the longer you leave it, the more difficult then it becomes to get back into the routine. And there's also a bit of shame, frankly, comes from, you know, trying to explain to the dentist why you haven't been for what for me became, let's be honest, decades rather than years. So ultimately, it did have a very serious effect on my oral health. And, you know, it was only when I got to the stage of having quite a lot of pain, a couple of big cavities and a couple of loose teeth that ended up coming out, mm-hmm. That was what it took to get me to going back to the dentist.
So Vishal, would you say that Gordon's experience is quite typical of someone that has a severe mental illness when it comes to oral health?
Yeah, absolutely. And the work we've done recently, looking at it on a population level, both in the UK and US, so it's not just limited to the UK, but it's a global problem where people with severe mental illness have much higher rates of gum disease, tooth decay, missing teeth, pain, you know, lack of access to a dentist. They don't frequently attend dentists. As Gordon said, it's associated with shame. And one of the things we find is there's a vicious cycle here, because oral health, really, people who've got severe mental illness experiencing poor oral health leads to social isolation, because a lot of people who we've interviewed, patients that with severe mental illness, have reported that they feel embarrassed going out. They think they've got bad breath, discolored teeth, especially if they've got dental decay. And they've got other issues because the medications they use cause dry mouth, which makes them more prone to dental decay. And you know, that can be a huge problem. Mm-hmm. And again, smoking, you know, the teeth get discolored. And it's really that these problems are preventable. Mm-hmm. So dental diseases, so good oral self-care behaviors like toothbrushing, you know, reducing frequency of sugar intake, stopping smoking, can actually prevent these conditions. And you know, so what Gordon's describing is the delay in getting help, which is really a problem.
So tell me a little bit then about this Right to Smile initiative that I know we were very grateful to receive and have a look at. It looks brilliant, but do you want to just talk through what the motivations behind that were and how that's going?
Yeah, absolutely. So as I said, you know, we started this work a long time ago. It's about 2014 when I got involved in the first trial with colleagues in Nottingham. And we showed a simple checklist prompt wasn't sufficient to improve oral health in people with psychosis. So if you prompt them to brush their teeth or visit the dentist, that wasn't sufficient. So it's more of a complex problem. And obviously now we know about the inequality and the vicious cycles that exist, that we need a whole team approach. Mm-hmm. And at the center of the team has to be the patient. And as I said, these gum disease and dental decay are preventable. So getting these messages out early was the motivation for that consensus statement. So at the point of diagnosis. So when somebody is diagnosed by, say, the psychiatrist, psychologist, or even at GP level, then oral health should be prioritized at that point. Mm-hmm. It's before it gets to what Gordon's described, losing teeth, when it's too late, really. And really, so that was the motivation to raise awareness amongst mental health workers and you know, mental health care professionals, mm-hmm. who diagnose people early on, and also amongst dentists, so that they can be aware that this is a huge problem, that vicious cycle, what poor oral health can do to mental health. And drive that vicious cycle, drive the patient into a spiral, mm-hmm. was the other reason for doing it. And then commissioners, because we know from the news, you will see NHS dentistry, there's huge problems around access. So could we prioritize it for this group of patients with severe mental illness? Because we know that is a huge oral health inequality for this population.
Mm-hmm. And it was really lovely to see that things are being done and things are being pushed for, and more importantly that people with lived experience were being consulted and asked to provide feedback. These people are actually being asked, okay, what would be good for you? So I mean, Gordon, how have you found, you know, sharing your lived experiences with these groups of people, and how receptive have you found that they've been?
I think the whole point of a consensus statement is to bring together people with lived experience, researchers and professionals in the dental field. And it's only by working together that we will understand each other's perspectives and come up with the right answers, frankly. Mm-hmm. It has to be done as a partnership project.
Yeah. If you think back to when you were going to see the dentist, maybe after you'd had a very long break, and how did you find they were? Like, did you tell them about, you know, okay, my mental health hasn't been great, which is maybe why I haven't been in so long? Or was that a conversation that you were able to have with the dental professional at the time?
Yeah, I mean, not on the first appointment, but with the number of problems I was turning up with, mm-hmm. as you would understand, there were a whole series of appointments when I eventually did go. And I think having not been to a dentist in probably about 30 years, I did notice an awful lot of change over that time, not surprisingly. Mm-hmm. And you know, ultimately, my dentist was very good and very supportive. You know, didn't castigate me too much for what I'd done or not done over the years, but instead concentrated on what we could do together to try and fix some of the issues that I had. So I think while it would be fair to say that I had a lot of trepidation leading up to the first appointment, it was nowhere near as bad as I feared it might be.
Mm-hmm. I think that's quite common with dentists, especially, that it's quite a common thing to get that nerves about going. Even if you go regularly, it's just, it happens to everybody. But yeah, like you say, if you haven't been for a long time and you've built it up, it's, yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, I think, I mean, let's be honest, nobody really likes going to the dentist, do they? Sorry, Vish. But, you know, it's something that we have to do, and it's something that we have to get over that mm-hmm. barrier. If we know that there is help there to support us, if we know that the treatment's going to be good, we know it's going to be to our benefit, I think we just need to get our mind into the right place and get on and do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's what it comes down to. Vishal, how can dental practitioners help with like the preventative side of helping someone with a severe mental illness, you know, things like counselling on brushing habits, diet, all the things that are covered in an appointment. I guess, what would your advice be to, if any practitioners have patients that they've identified as having a severe mental illness or psychosis or similar?
So I guess I'd go back to what Gordon just mentioned there, that mm-hmm. he worked together with his dentist, and it's a partnership. I think that where you get into difficulty is when you try and tell the patient this is what's wrong and this is what needs fixing. And I guess it's about understanding the problem from the patient's perspective. So maybe looking at the impact. What impact is that oral health having, or the lack of good oral health having? And what are the priorities for that patient? Mm-hmm. You know, so it may be, so traditionally we are taught to cure the underlying problem, so the gum disease or the the decay, and start working with prevention from the outset with the patient, and only until they comply do we start intervening. But it may be with somebody with severe mental illness, they might need to see the positive impact first. So you might give them a good clean around their teeth and a polish, they get their smile back and they say, well, actually, that's great, you know, I'm going to start working on this. So it's that initial starting point that needs to be really in partnership with the patient, and understanding what is it that they're looking for and how is the lack of poor oral health impacting them, mm-hmm. not just around their teeth but around their general well-being, because you know, oral health can impact all aspects, really. Your aesthetics, as we talked about, your smile, the bad breath, is it preventing them from socializing? And so working at that and then achieving those goals and setting mm-hmm. targets for the next appointment, and then saying to the patient, look, let's work together. If you brush your teeth, this won't happen again. The cleaning I've done, or I've got your smile back. If you keep doing this, you know, it would be able to stop it because it's preventable. Mm-hmm. The same with the decay that's associated with frequency of sugar intake. So I don't know what Gordon would say to this, but I presume people in this, and we've shown that people will be snacking frequently and maybe having a lot of sugary drinks. So you see, fizzy drinks as well can be absolutely harmful for your teeth. So it's about reducing the intake of these sugary drinks and foods to meal times, mm-hmm. and in between meals having the right foods which are protective for the teeth. Mm-hmm. So it's very simple changes, but not making wholesale changes which will result in non-compliance. Carers can come on board as well. Mm-hmm. And I think if dentists, if people with mental health have carers, then maybe bring them to the appointment, or family members who can support that plan and have a real key oral health plan to work with.
Mm-hmm. On that point, So people that aren't in the community and are in an inpatient facility, how then does the dental system capture those people and make sure that they're able to take care of their teeth? And obviously in certain situations, diet and things are very regimented, and it differs person to person like anybody. But if someone's not in the community and able to go and see like a community dentist, what then happens with those patients?
That's a really good question. And one of the things we're working with now is getting other mental health professionals involved and understanding oral health, because they're very simple things you can do, you know, regulating sugar intake or brushing teeth, making sure within those inpatient facilities, those are prioritized, which often they're not. You know, we've had stories of people not brushing their teeth within hospitals, not having the opportunity if they don't have their toothbrush. You know, are those available within that hospital setting? And there are dental and oral surgery departments within hospitals. So there are dentists who work within a hospital department, so they can be consulted. So it doesn't necessarily have to be in the community, but they would be dealing with the immediate problems if there was any urgent dental problems. But the issue is for that spiral not to start in the first place. If they can keep brushing their teeth, fluoride toothpaste, you know, regulate sugar intake, then it can be a really good way of preventing it and keeping on top of things while they're inpatients. And then that habit can carry on outside.
Yeah.
We go back into the community. And you see, this brings me back to lack of dentists. So there is a lack of access to dentists, and if we can get other people involved, we're even working with groups of pharmacists now to see if they can provide simple oral health preventative messages. And GPs as well can be at the center of this. So the team that we've got with the consensus statement includes GPs, dentists, mm-hmm. mental health workers, psychiatrists, psychologists, and people with lived experience and carers. So David Shears, who's been instrumental with the consensus statement, is a carer mm-hmm. and has experienced firsthand how, you know, a person he's caring for has had poor oral care when they've been within an inpatient facility and out in the community.
Mm-hmm. That's a common theme that I've heard a lot, because I've over the last month or so I've spoken to a lot of different people with different backgrounds, so like dental therapists, nurses, hygienists, people that go and do community stuff, and the common theme it seems to come down to is education, that the education isn't there with a lot of medical professionals about how to help someone, say, with a dry mouth, or help make sure someone's cleaning properly, or help with anything that can be pinned down to oral health. There isn't enough education there.
Absolutely. So it may be about just changing the medication, which would boil down to the GP knowing that a dry mouth has got deleterious consequences on oral health. So mm-hmm. yes, absolutely. And I think one of the things research has shown, education doesn't change behavior. If you increase patients' knowledge or a practitioner's knowledge, you know, it will not change patient behavior. So it's not a one-stop shop. It's about monitoring, bringing the patient back in and mm-hmm. saying, are you doing this? Are you able to comply with it? Are there any problems? How can we support you? So it's this can happen in dental practices where you see the patient for a visit and then you're not seen again for 6 months, and that can be too long. So patients with severe mental illness will need a regular recall until you can achieve that stabilization of their oral health.
Mm-hmm. With yourself, Gordon, does that sort of ring true as to what you experienced when you were, you know, going back and sorting out your oral health and working with a dentist?
It does, yeah. I mean, so much of this is about habits and getting into the right habits. And, you know, once you begin to see the gains from good dental treatment, then I think, you know, naturally you do begin to think, okay, you know, I've gone through the hard part, I've begun to make some changes. It's up to me now to continue doing the good things and make sure I don't go back to where I was. Mm-hmm. There's something, I guess, quite human about that feeling of sort of having achieved something and wanting to protect the achievements and build on them. So, yeah, I think my dental habits are now much better than they were before.
Which is brilliant. That's what we want. Well, do you, either of you, have any golden pieces of advice, for lack of a better term, that you would share, either Gordon, if there's anyone with bipolar or a similar mental health condition that does find taking care of their oral health challenging, from your experience, what's helped you, and with Vishal as well, any information that you would share to those who are experiencing ill mental health?
It's difficult to think about prioritising oral health when you often have many challenges in your life. But I think, like many aspects of healthcare, early treatment is really the key to this. So, you know, not letting problems build up and having to deal with them later like I did. It's far better to get in there early. So I think what I would say is get help, seek out a dentist. You know, they're quite nice people, really. They will help you get in the system, get regular checkups, get into those good habits, and you'll see the benefits in the long run.
Yeah, I would completely second and echo that, Gordon. It's about getting early intervention and initiating those habits early. But also remember, you can look after your own teeth. All these conditions are preventable. So find a dentist early, get help before it spirals out. If you're embarrassed, don't let that play on your mind, and just go out there and get some help. Look at the consensus statement. There's some links to some really good leaflets there that can give you some real good tips on self-care, using a fluoride toothpaste, brushing twice a day, techniques on how to brush your teeth, interdental brushing between your teeth, and avoiding snacking on sugary foods and drinks, which can be pretty harmful. There's saliva substitutes for dry mouth as well that can be used. So, mm-hmm. you know, see your GP about changing medications if you're getting those symptoms.
Mm-hmm. But like you say, if it's not possible to change medications, then there are those things that you can use in addition to help with dry mouth and saliva, and sometimes chewing gum as well is what we say to people, is have a chewing gum, and it helps with the saliva.
Sugar-free chewing gum is great. It stimulates saliva, but that neutralizes acid. So that's brilliant. And I'd just say prevention is the key.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The same with everything, really, isn't it?
Put us out of business as dentists.
But that's what we want. We want healthy mouths. That's what we want.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you very much, both of you, for spending some time out of your day talking to me. If anyone wants to find out more information about the consensus as well, I will put all of it in the podcast description, and I'll put a link up on our website as well. The Oral Health Foundation are happy to support it, and so we will be able to share it wherever we can share things. So, so thank you very, very, very much, both of you, and have a lovely day.
Thanks
for having us. Yeah.
Dr. Vishal Agarwal and Gordon Johnston there, talking about mental illness and oral health. Now, if you want to learn more about that, we'll link all the information about the consensus in the description of this podcast. It's really interesting read, so I hope that if you do go and have a look at it, you find it very insightful. If you'd like to learn more about Smile Month, you can go to smilemonth.org, as well as following us on social media. And if you want some more bespoke oral health advice, then you can talk to our helpline free of charge, and I'll link all of their information below too. Now, thank you for listening this month. It has been very, very interesting. We've had a lot of really good conversations, so I hope that you have enjoyed, and I hope that you also enjoy the rest of your day.